So about 15 years ago, the Ontario government decided to really reform its primary care system. So at that time, most doctors were paid by the visit. So every time a patient came in, they got paid a certain fee for seeing them. Most of them worked alone in their own offices. And we understood that we weren't actually getting the outcomes, the quality of care. Patients were getting the access that they really needed, that we could get from our primary care system. Now, about 3/4 of Ontario's doctors actually work in groups. So the government actually provided physicians a number of financial incentives to come together in groups to pool their resources to provide after-hours care to their group of patients together. So another key aspect of the reforms were changing how doctors got paid. So instead of just pay by the visit, there was more money set aside for what we call capitation, or a lump sum payment per patient per year. Now, doctors had a choice about whether they wanted to move into these new group models. And patients had a choice also about whether they wanted to sign up with their doctor and formally enroll. So because moving into these group models was voluntary for physicians and patients had a choice about whether to enroll, we wondered if the most vulnerable were being left behind. We know that sometimes reforms are taken up by those who are already at the forefront, who are already organized and providing some of the best care. And even from a patient perspective, we know that sometimes the patients who can advocate for themselves are more likely to get the care that they need. And so we really wanted to understand whether factors like poverty or immigration influenced whether patients were being served in these new group models. We studied anonymized health records for about 13 million Ontarians, so really everyone who lived in the province of Ontario, between 2001, so before the Enroll reforms were introduced, to 2011. And so we were really interested in understanding the characteristics of patients who signed up in these new group practices, and also the characteristics of physicians who joined. And we really wanted to know what was the quality of care received by the patients in these new group practices compared to the patients left out or left behind from these group practices. So we found that patients who were left behind from these new group practices, they were actually more likely to live in urban areas, they were more likely to live in low-income neighborhoods, and they were more likely to have immigrated to Canada in the last 10 years. Unfortunately, we also find that they were more likely to get poor quality of care. So they were less likely to get the recommended testing for diabetes, and they were less likely to get screened for cervical, breast, or colorectal cancer. I think one of the surprising things that we found was not even just that they had poor quality of care in 2011 when we compared what their quality of care was like with patients who were in the group practices, but actually their quality of care was poorer than the patients in group practices even if you went back to 2001 before the reforms were introduced. And so that says to me that this was a vulnerable group even before the reforms. They were less likely to get good quality of care, yet somehow the reforms didn't benefit them. What can we do differently next time around? So our study found that some patients in Ontario are just not getting the care that they need and that they deserve. So how can we help these patients? These patients are more likely to be new to Canada, living in poor areas, and probably don't know how to advocate for themselves or navigate our health system. So we probably need to do a better job at reaching out to those patients, explaining to them what good primary care looks like, and helping them connect to a family doctor. Now, this is pretty timely because actually in Queen's Park right now, there's new legislation called the Patients First Act that the government hopes to implement as soon as spring 2017. And a really key part of the Patients First Act is actually trying to attach every patient to a family doctor. It's really exciting that there are new primary care reforms underway, and I think we can really learn from the past to ensure that we don't make the same mistakes again. I'd say one thing that I would encourage is for us to really be clear about what we want to see from these new reforms, and actually evaluate as we go along, are we achieving that? I'd also also say I think we need to be very mindful of our vulnerable populations and really understand whether reforms are helping those most in need. Sometimes we design our reforms with sort of the average person in mind, and sometimes our more vulnerable populations actually need a different approach.